Well, good evening. Hope you had a good afternoon, and good to be with you this evening. Let's stand together. Page 225, Angels We Have Heard on High. Continue celebrating the Christmas season together as we sing 225, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echo back their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
We'll sing together on that last. Anyone get out of breath while you're singing that Gloria there? I saw a couple of you taking a big heave in the middle of that. Let's sing on that last verse. See him in a manger laid.
See him in a manger laid. Jesus, Lord of heaven and earth. Mary, Joseph, lend your aid. With us sing our Savior.
Good evening. Good to see you tonight, and I hope you had a good afternoon this afternoon. We're giving the choir a little bit of a break. I think they've earned it, don't you, after all last weekend, and so hope they can rest up a little bit, but glad you're here with us tonight. Chuck, would you mind opening us a word of prayer? Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Well, with the choir not singing tonight, we're going to sing two songs back to back right now. We'll sit for the first one. We'll stand for the second one. Let's go to page 195, God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. Page 195 this evening, God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power while we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy from God our unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same, how that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name.
we'll sing on that last.
Now to the Lord sing praises, all you within this place, and with true love and brotherhood, each other now embrace. This holy tide of Christmas, all others doth deface. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Let's stand together. We'll sing this second one in our back-to-back. Page 208, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. And this is actually one of my favorites when you look at the words of this song and just how powerful they are, looking forward to that Emmanuel, looking forward to that Messiah. And really the same thought process of this morning, an answered prayer, O come, Jesus, Messiah, come. Let's sing together, 208, O come, Emmanuel.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns and lonely
together on that last.
O come, thou King of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads high, and show the path that brings us nigh. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel.
Would you come forward? We'll take this evening's tithes and offerings. And then we mentioned them this morning, but if you continue to pray for my dad, I would appreciate that. He's recovering over at Ball Hospital. And then pray for Betty Tuggle as well. She had her pacemaker put in. Any other prayer requests this evening? Yes, Troy. Oh, okay. Yeah, Trent Dillinger had foot surgery this last Wednesday, and it sounds like he's still in some discomfort with that, so pray for him if you would, all right? Anyone else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Tyler, would you mind doing that for us? Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
right. Well, we are kind of coming down to the end of 2022, which is hard to believe, and not a lot of announcements left on this year's calendar, but I got to tell you, I am very excited for next year. We've got some things planned, some ministries we're looking at, and I think it's going to be an exciting year. I'm excited to see what the Lord's going to do. But today I've just got three announcements for you, so I'll give you those. Back on the back table, I know many of you have already gotten them, but if you haven't gotten your Christmas cards yet, take a peek back there, and there may be some for you. And then next week is our Christmas Day, and so remember the schedule change. It'll be an 11 o'clock service, and that is it. And then, kiddos, you're allowed to wear your pajamas that day, and I think that'll be a fun time. And are you all wearing your pajamas? The rule is, if you wear pajamas, you got to come on stage so everybody can see you. So that's the rule, all right? And then the following week is New Year's. And again, kind of, yes, Norma. If you wake up in the morning and don't hurt, you can wear PJs. That's the rules. That's how we'll do it. Does that work for everybody? New Year's, again, a little schedule change on that. Want to give you a little bit of a break. So no evening service that night. And then combined Sunday school, try to give our teachers a little bit of a break. They've worked hard this year, and appreciate them with all that. All right. Well, we have our college students home with us for Christmas break. And one of our college students, Sophie, actually got selected to go on a missions trip this summer, and I'll let her come and tell some of the details about that, and also how we as a church can kind of support her and help her with that. So Sophie, why don't you come and kind of fill us in what's going on.
Hola, me llamo Sophie, y tengo la oportunidad de viajar a Santiago, Chile el verano próximo. For those of you who don't speak Spanish, I am going to Chile next summer, Santiago, Chile. And basically, this all came about. We have Mission Sunday at Campus Church, and a missionary came to speak, and it really burdened my heart to go back to the mission field, because many of you guys know we went to Africa several years ago, and that was fantastic. But this missionary just had a phenomenal message, and I was like, Lord, can you just please use me again? And the very next day, one of my previous Spanish teachers came to me and he said, I've been approved to take a group to Chile. Would you like to go? And I was like, absolutely. I was like, Lord, thank you. You heard me. So I signed up for that missions trip. I was a little stressed about it because only 12 people could go. But I was selected to go. And basically what we'll be doing is working with junior, senior high school kids. It's during the summer. So I think they have like a summer school for that. But we'll be teaching them English and like teaching them Bible verses in English and stuff like that. And it will also help me to practice Spanish because that's my minor at PCC right now. So I'm trying to be fluent in it, as you can tell, if you're speaking Spanish. But the trip is gonna be next summer from June 19th to July 2nd. And the total is $2,500. So PCC has asked me to send out support letters. So I've tried to get all of your guys' addresses and names. And I'm sending you guys letters, so hopefully you can get those later this week, if not next week. If I forgot you, I'm really sorry, but there's a lot of you guys. So I have a QR code that I'm gonna post on Facebook, and if you guys aren't on Facebook, if you can help me by the little offertory slip that's in the pews, if you can give that way and clearly mark it that it's for to help me to go to Chile, that would be fantastic. So I should be sending out support letters. There's going to be the QR code on Facebook, or you can give through the offering. Any of those ways would be fantastic to help me go. If you guys have any more questions and want to know more about what I'll be doing, you can just come and ask me. But muchas gracias.
Amen. That's exciting. It's a good opportunity, not just for the people of Chile, but what an impact it makes on those who go to those mission trips, and just how God uses that and the people we serve, but also while we're serving, how God uses us. We'll sing one more song this evening. You can remain seated. Page 226, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let's sing together. 226, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
O little town of still we see thee lie upon sleep, the angels keep their watch of wandering love. All morning stars together proclaim the holy birth, and praises sing to God the King, and peace to men.
We'll sing on that last.
O holy child of Bethlehem, descend, O us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell.
That Jocelyn, great job this evening, and I'm excited that Sophie's going to Chile. She went with us when we went to Botswana, and I tell you what, she is just wired for missions trips like that, isn't she? If you were there on that trip, and she'll do a great job. It's kind of new as far as you just found out a little bit ago and don't have all the details yet, but it'll be a great experience, and however we can help her, we want to do that, amen. So excited for her on that. Would you turn with me to Acts chapter 12? Acts chapter 12, and one of the things we're going to do next year when we start our Sunday nights is we're going to go through the book of Mark, and I'm excited about that. I think it's going to be a good study for us, and tonight what I'd like to do is kind of introduce the book of Mark, and I want to do that by introducing the author, by a guy by the name of Mark, as you probably figured, and you may be more familiar with him by the name John Mark. You've probably heard of John Mark before. And what I want you to do is, next year as we kind of go through this book, I want you to keep in the back of your mind who wrote this. And really, just the fact that John Mark is the author of the book of Mark is a testament in and of itself to the grace of God. That God would take a guy who really, he blew it and he failed, and yet God still chose to use him, and it's just an incredible thing. I'll read our verse to get us started, and we'll pray, and then I'll show you where we're going tonight. Acts chapter 12, in verse 12, it says this, "And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying." Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this Christmas season and just all the good ministry that's taken place and the way that you've allowed us to be part of what you're doing. We thank you for it. And Lord, I pray that you'd be with us tonight as we look at this man, John Mark, and the things that you taught him and the way you restored him and the hope it gives us in our lives as we look at what our future is going to look like. We praise you for this man. I praise you for what you do in our lives. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. In 1890, there was a guy by the name of Harlan that was born in Henryville, Indiana. Anybody heard of Henryville, Indiana before? I had not till I read this story. At the age of 5, this boy, his father passed away, and his mom had to go work long hours at a factory, leaving him to stay home and take care of his siblings. He had a hard life. By the time he got to his 30s, he had a hard time keeping a job, and he came home one day from work to find that his wife and kids had left him, and the note she left behind simply said this. The note she left said she had no business marrying a no-good fellow like you that can't hold a job. By the time he was 65, the new highway that had been put in took traffic away from his small little restaurant, and his restaurant that he owned went bankrupt, and he was left in retirement receiving $105 a week as his income. For the next 2 years, he lived in his car, and he went from restaurant to restaurant trying to sell them his chicken recipe. It says that he went to 1,009 different restaurants, all of which saying no to his offer until he finally got a yes, and that was the first yes that was given to a man that we know as Colonel Sanders. Have you heard of Colonel Sanders before? Within 9 years, his chicken would have sold, he would have been sold in 600 restaurants, and he would be a multi-millionaire. Now, there's something exciting about a comeback story, isn't there? There's something exciting about a guy that things aren't going the way you're hoping they're going, and all of a sudden it turns around. Anybody watch that Colts game yesterday? I watched that thing, and I haven't watched them much this year, and I saw we were up 33-0 in the third quarter, if you hadn't seen this. And somehow, through a lot of hard work, we found a way to give that thing away. And by the end, we lost that game. And I remember watching, I'm a Colts fan, but at the end, did anybody else find yourself rooting for the Vikings? You're like, you deserve this at this point. There's just something about us that likes to see a comeback. And I tell you, a comeback's exciting in a career, a comeback's exciting in sports, but I tell you, a comeback is even better in life. And if you're here today and 2022 didn't quite go the way that you had hoped it would go, let me encourage you, we serve a God of second chances. If you came through 2022 and your hopes that this year was going to be a year where you would really dive into God's Word and develop a devotional life, and that just didn't happen, let me encourage you, it's not over yet. If this last year you thought this was going to be the year that you were going to develop a prayer life and you'd become a man or woman of prayer, and you feel like you failed in that area of your life, let me encourage you, John Mark knows what that's like. If this last year you decided you wanted to live a year where you served God and it really feels like you served sin more than you served God, I think John Mark will be an encouragement to you. John Mark, he is a man that discovered that God's mercies are new every morning. He encourages us that no matter who you are, no matter what your track record is, no matter what you are doing currently in life, it reminds us that God specializes in taking things that are broken, things that are not working, things that are failing, and he revives them and rejuvenates them, and he gives them a second chance, and he uses them
for his glory. And that's what God did for John Mark, and that's what God is willing to do for us. I think of John Mark, and you think of all the men in the Jerusalem church that God could have sprinkled their story throughout the New Testament, but he chose to use the life of John Mark. And you see him a little bit in the book of Acts. You see him possibly a little bit in the book of Mark. We'll look at that when we get to it. You see him in Paul's writings. And you can kind of piece the verses together and get a big picture of his life. And what you find out was that God took a man that failed, and he restored him, and he used him. And I just want to encourage you this evening that when you walk away tonight, that you have some hope for 2023. If you haven't been what God wanted you to be in 2022, it doesn't mean that it's over. Yeah, there's still hope. There are hope for our marriages. There's hope for our families. There's hope for your walk with God. There's hope for your prayer life. We have a God who specializes in comeback stories. Well, let's look at Mark a little bit. We start out in Acts chapter 12, verse 12, and we see Mark's foundation. Mark's foundation, where he came from, and it tells us in Acts 12:12 that he had a very godly home. The story we are taking this verse out of is, do you remember the story of Peter? When he is put into prison and he's about to be executed the next day, and all of a sudden the angel comes and frees him from jail, and he's standing in the middle of the street in the middle of the night. He thinks to himself, where am I going to go? And he thinks, oh, I am going to go to Mary's house. And he goes to Mary's house, and sure enough, there was a church prayer meeting going on in Mary's house. Now, what does that tell you? The fact that Peter's first instinct was to go to Mary's house means that this was probably a regular meeting place for the local church. Back then, they would meet in local houses. I don't know if you know this or not, but our church started in the living room of a local house. And it grew to what it is today, but it started in a house just like the church in Jerusalem would often meet. And John Mark's mom was the one that hosted the church in her house for church services. I tell you, that's a godly mother, isn't it? A godly mother that's going to make sure that her son is around the things of God and the people of God and around the church of God. John Mark, he didn't have a chance. He couldn't stay home from church. His home was the church, right? He had to be there. How many of you growing up, you had a mom or a dad that you were going to be in church? Anybody have a parent like that? I tell you what, that's a blessing. You don't see that all the time today. And I tell you, young people, if you have that today, be thankful for that. If you have someone that loves you enough, that cares enough about you to make sure that you're around the things of God, you're in the house of God, that's a good thing. John Mark, he came from a godly home, we see from Acts chapter 12. And not only did John come from a godly home, but he was also surrounded by godly mentors. You know, we never see anything said about Mark's dad through the scriptures. A lot of theologians believe he had passed away. We don't know that. But regardless, Mark was surrounded by godly men in his life. So think of some of the influences that John Mark would have been around. As a young man, he most likely would have sat underneath the preaching of Jesus. It doesn't get much better than that, does it? He would have hung around the disciples. When the day would be over and they would come, and they would come to Mary's house, and they'd sit around the table and they'd talk and they'd tell stories. And my guess is they probably told stories about Jesus that aren't even in Scripture. And Mark's sitting there and he's taking all this in. He had a guy in his life by the name of Barnabas. Do you remember Barnabas? Mr. Encourager? His uncle, and he had that man in his life. He had Paul in his life. He got to go on a missions trip with Paul, probably the greatest missionary to ever live. And all these guys were influences around and in the life of John Mark. And I tell you what, that made a big difference. I tell you, just because these men were not his biological father did not mean that they couldn't make an impact in this man's life. I tell you, that's a principle we should take away with us, isn't it? You know, you don't have to be related to someone to mentor them and to invest in them and to disciple them. As a church, what should our heartbeat be for the young people in our church? We should want to see them follow the Lord, and we should try to do everything we can to help them in that area. When Gene retired from the class, we had a poster made as a gift, as a picture type thing, and And the inscription we had put on it was this: your greatest contribution to the kingdom of God may not be something you do, but someone you teach. I tell you, there's a lot of truth to that. The biggest impact you can make may be on someone else that's up and coming. It may be one of the kids you're teaching in your Sunday school class. It may be someone who helps you in the ministry that you run. And John Mark, he was surrounded by godly men, by a godly mother, and that had a large impact on the way his life turned out at the end. We see Mark's foundation. He came from a godly home. He had godly mentors. Not only do we see Mark's foundation, but then we also see Mark's failure. Look over, if you would, to verse 25, still in chapter 12, but look at Acts chapter 12, verse 25. It says, "And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them John, whose surname was Mark." Here, Paul and Barnabas were going on their missionary journey, and Mark wants to go with them. Now, I think there's something to be said for that, don't you? Mark, he was the one that was willing to go on the trip, while there's probably hundreds of other young men who stayed home. I think sometimes we may be a little too hard on John Mark. I think sometimes we may be harder on him than he deserves. Because there is seeming to be a desire in him that he wanted to go on this trip, and he wanted to serve the Lord, and he wanted to see people saved, and he wanted to be used by God. And there was at least a desire in his heart that wanted to please God. And some of you this year, maybe you came into it and you had the desire to follow God. You had the desire to be in God's Word. You had the desire to develop a prayer life. And even though you may not have achieved that this last year, I tell you, that's a good sign that you have the desire. Wouldn't you agree? The young person that desires to be at church and desires to be in God's Word, but they fail, I worry much less about them than I do the teenager that has no heart to be in church and no heart to read God's Word. Are you with me? The fact that you have at least the desire to do what's right is a sign that God's working in your heart. And so be encouraged by that. John Mark, he at least had the desire to go. He at least had the desire to be used. And the fact that you had the desire to honor God is a good thing. But even though he had the desire, look what happens over in chapter 13 and verse 13. He says, "Now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga and to Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem." Here, John, he had the desire to go on the missionary journey, but something happens after they go to a city called Paphos, and Mark decides to go home. He quits the trip. He quits the journey. He returns to Jerusalem, and we don't know exactly why. We can guess. You can read all the different commentaries, and they all have different explanations or guesses why John Mark would have left. Some say it's because they had just met a really weird guy at their last stop. And it said it was too much for him, and so he couldn't handle it, and he went home. Some say that the reason he quit may have been because of personal pride. You see, his uncle Barnabas had been the head dog on these missionary trips, and the pendulum had just swung to where now it was Paul that was the main dog, and Barnabas was the number two guy, and maybe it was that. Maybe he didn't like that. Maybe he was just homesick. Maybe he missed his mom and he missed his friends. You ever been homesick before? That's not an easy thing. It may have just been that it was harder than he thought. From studying John Mark's home, it seems like they lived in a fairly good-sized house and had fairly good income, and they were wealthy, and he lived a comfortable life. And now here he is, probably packing luggage for Barnabas and Paul and traveling from city to city, and it just may have been harder than he thought it was going to be to go on the trip. Whatever the reason, he failed. He blew it. The team was counting on him, and instead of coming through, he got halfway there, and he quit. He quit on the Lord. He quit on Paul. He quit on Barnabas. He quit on his mission. He quit, and he failed. And you know, the truth is, even godly men are going to fall at times. The question really isn't, are you going to fall? The question really is, what are you going to do when you fall? God tells us in Proverbs 24:16, "For a just man falleth seven times and rises up again. When I was a kid, we had this little toy, and I was reminded of it. I was at Menards a couple of nights ago with our kids, and it was there in the toy section. It was, do you remember the inflatable punching bags? Anybody remember those? And you'd blow this thing up, and it was, I don't know, 5 foot tall, something like that, and it had sand or something at the bottom. And the whole purpose of it was you could punch that thing and kick that thing, and it would go down, and then about 2 seconds later, just pop right back up, right? And you're 5, 6 years old, and you're a superhero, whatever, and you'll go, and you'll just beat the tar out of that thing, and you'd think you had it down for the count, it'd pop right back up. And it'd knock it down, pop right back up. At the end of the day, you'd get tired and walk away, and it'd still be standing. You with me? You seen that toy? You know, the truth of a godly man is not whether or not he is going to fall. We are all sinful men with sin natures that are going to fail in some form, shape, or another. The question is, what are we going to do when we fall? Well, when you have a poor devotional life, are you content with that, or are you going to make a change about it? Well, when you're living in sin, are you okay with that, or are you going to do something about it? And Mark, he had his failure. But I like this point. Not only do we see Mark's foundation, not only do we see Mark's failure, but third of all, we see Mark's friends. You know, Mark had some friends in his life that God really used to restore him. One of those guys was the guy by the name of Barnabas. We've talked about that already. We talked about him this last year when we studied the book of Acts. His nickname was literally Mr. Encourager. He was a guy that would come beside you and he would lift you up and he would encourage you, and that seems to be what he did for Mark. Paul, do you remember Paul? Paul was the very black and white, and if he failed once, we're not going to give him another chance type guy. And he said, let's get rid of John Mark. Let's not let him on any more of our missionary journeys. But what did Barnabas do? He said, let's give him another chance. Let's build him up a little bit. Let's encourage him a little bit. And let's see what God can do with him if we come alongside him and help him. Barnabas came beside him, and the other man that seems to have really been a mentor to Mark was a guy by the name of Peter. In 1 Peter 5:13, Peter refers to Mark as my son. In fact, the book of Mark that we're going to study next year seems to largely be taken from the accounts and the preaching and the stories of Peter. And Mark had become the disciple of Peter. And isn't that a perfect fit? Because do you remember, if there's anyone that knew what it was like to overcome failure, it was Peter. And here Peter comes alongside him and he encourages him and he builds him up. And by God's grace, they help restore Mark to usefulness. God put godly men in Mark's life to help restore him. I tell you what, that's how it should be. As a church, when one of us fails, the rest of us should come alongside, and our goal should be to help restore that one that's fallen. Amen? I had a situation a couple months ago, and I didn't know how to handle it. And so I was in the office, Dad was in the office, and so I said, Dad, what would you do with this situation? I kind of laid it out for him. And he said, do you have your Bible there? I said, yeah. He said, open your Bible to Galatians 6, verse 1, and read it to me. And so I opened it to Galatians 6, 1, and I read this. I said, brethren, if any man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. And I finished reading that verse, and he looked at me and he said, that's your goal. He said, your goal is to help that person and to restore them to what God always intended them to be. We were over at Mark and Wanda's a couple months ago at this point. And Mark had taken this old tractor that used to belong to Wanda's dad, if I'm getting this right, 53 Ford, is that right? And when he got it, it was in a barn. And I brought a picture of it. You can put it up there. And from what I understand, this is already, after it's been cleaned up a little bit, it had been under some bird's nest and all the repercussions that come with that and all that sort of thing. And And Mark took this tractor and he hauled it home to his workshop. And that was when your back was giving you trouble. And so he couldn't do a whole lot of other things, but one thing he could do is he could sand. And so for the next, I don't know how many hours do you think you spent sanding that thing, Mark?
Month.
Month, yeah. And he would sand and sand. He took the parts apart, and little by little, he took the rust off and patched parts that were too rusted through. And whatever it needed, he started to restore this thing. And by the time I got there, this is what it looked like. He had totally restored that thing to what it was originally intended to be. What does God say in Galatians chapter 6? He says, ye that are spiritual. In other words, if you are a godly man, if you are a godly woman, your goal when someone in your church family falls is not to make them your enemy. It's not to kick them while they're down. It's not to talk about them behind their back. Your goal, if you are a spiritual man, is to help restore them to what God wants them to be. And he says, do this in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou fall into the same trap. It's the idea of not restoring them out of arrogance, not looking down on someone that has failed, but coming to it with humility, not overestimating ourselves. It's coming to it with the realization that without God's grace, we would have failed in just the same way they have currently failed. You know, I think sometimes we can deceive ourselves into thinking we're farther away from failure than we really are. With our sin nature, it wouldn't take much for us to fail in the same way the other guy failed. If it weren't for God's grace, we could have the same addiction, or we could have the same moral failure, or we could have the same relationship problems. And he says the goal of a godly man is to come to one that has fallen and to restore them to what God has always intended them to be. Can't you just see Peter doing that with John Mark? Can't you just see him coming up to John Mark and putting his arm around him and saying, hey, listen, I know you blew it. I know you failed. But let me tell you how I failed. Let me tell you how I denied Christ. And let me tell you how Christ came to me and he forgave me and he restored me and he used me. And John, the same way he did it for me, he can do it for you. And I love that part of the story, that God put good men around John Mark to help restore him to what God wanted him to be. And then finally, we see Mark's future. Look at Mark's future. Would you flip over with me, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. And if you remember at all when we studied 2 Timothy, this is kind of the end of Paul's life. At this point, he doesn't expect to be released from prison. He doesn't think he's going to be on this earth much longer, and he had this split, this rift with John Mark, and basically said that you are unprofitable, you cannot be used, and listen to what he says in 2 Timothy 4:11. He says, only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for ministry. In Colossians 4, 10 and 11, Paul says that Mark is a fellow worker unto the kingdom of God, and that he is a comfort to him. So get this, the same Mark that had quit on God, the same Mark that had failed, and the same one that Paul had said wasn't worthy to be used of God anymore, was now called a servant, he was called profitable, and by the way, he's the same one that wrote one of the four gospels that we're going to be studying this coming year. Are you not glad that we serve a God of second chances? I think about the Bible and some of the people that God used. Think about the preacher by the name of Jonah. That in rebellion, he ran away from God. But in the next chapter, it says that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Do you remember a disciple by the name of Peter that denied Christ three times? And yet we see Christ come to him a couple of chapters later and restore him and then use him in the greatest evangelistic message that was ever given. Think of Paul. Do you remember how he was a murderer by the name of Saul, and yet God changed him and gave him a second act where he was the greatest missionary this world had ever known? Think about David. and how he slept with Bathsheba and he lost a child because of it, and yet God still let him raise a Solomon. Think about a lady by the name of Rahab. She sold her body for a living, and yet when she turned to Christ, she ended up marrying a Jewish guy and had a son who had a son who had a son named Jesse who eventually had a son named David. We have a God who can turn things around. We have a God who gives second chances. I heard one pastor say that God's favorite room is lost and found. In 1929, the Rose Bowl between Georgia Tech and California University, there was a player by the name of Roy Raggles that played for California. And as the first half was coming to a close, there was a fumble, and Roy Raggles picked up the fumble and ran 65 yards towards the end zone. The problem was it was the wrong end zone. And within 5 yards of the Georgia Tech touched end zone, one of his teammates tackled him, but it wouldn't matter because Georgia Tech would go on to score a touchdown and take a lead heading into halftime. At halftime, Coach Price would come in and speak to the team, and he gave an inspiring halftime speech with which he concluded with the phrase, "Starters back out on the field." The team jumped up, they ran to the field, everyone except Roy Raggles. Roy Raggles sat on the bench with his head down. His coach came up to him. He said, "Coach, I can't go back out there." He said, "I've ruined the game. I've ruined my reputation. I've ruined my career. I've ruined your career." He said, "I can't go back out." To which Roy's coach said this. He said, "Roy, get up and get back out there. The game's only half over." I tell you, that's pretty good advice. You come through this last year and your walk with God hasn't been what it needs to be. Your prayer life hasn't been what it needs to be. Your victory over sin hasn't been what it needs to be. Let me just encourage you, there's still more time on the clock. And we can't go back and change what's been before, but we can go forward in God's grace and we can live in victory the next year, amen? And I love the story of John Mark. He's a guy that gives us hope. Because I don't know about you, but I fail more often than I'd like to admit. I'm thankful that we have a God who is merciful enough to give us second chances and to still use us. Let me encourage you as we head into this new year, if this last year hasn't been what it needs to be, there's another year coming, and God's mercies are new every day. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the story of John Mark and just the picture that it represents to us. It's just one picture in many in Scripture of a man or a woman that has failed, and yet you in your graciousness and your mercy choose to restore and to use, and it gives us such hope. And Lord, if there's one here that in their marriage or their walk with you or a struggle with sin have lived in failure this last year, Lord, I pray that you would give them hope tonight, that you're a God of second chances, you're a God that gives grace so we can live victoriously, and we thank you for that. Pray that you'll be with us as we go out this week and all these things we say in your name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? Turn to hymn number
483.
Hymn 483 as we sing together.
I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home. Coming home. Never
trust you enjoy your Christmas week this week, and a reminder, different schedule this coming Sunday, but looking forward to it. Should be a good time. Brother JR, would you mind closing us in prayer this evening?